Hello, I welcome you all to this 8 weeks, 20-hour course on quantum computing and information under the aegis of NPTEL platform. And in this very first lecture, what I will do today is to tell you what is this quantum computing. As you are all aware, this has not been a traditional subject of physics or computer science for that matter, and it is only during the last 20 years or so that this subject has come to prominence, and it is still in a lot of developmental stage. So I will go through the scope of this course, but to begin with, I would like to tell you why quantum computing. After all, we have had computers for quite some time, at least 4 or 5 decades, and what is so special about quantum computing? The first thing that you might try to tell me, that even the classical computing is based on transistors and other electronic components. So which means that these things like transistors and other electronic components, which are parts of the integrated circuits which are used in a classical computer, they are also based on quantum mechanics. So what is so special about it? The difference is the following, that the modern computing as we know it is based on laws of classical physics, and of course they are based on mathematical logic. We will still continue to have a lot of dependence on mathematical logic, but we will see that the laws of classical physics, which seem to operate on the computers that we have become accustomed to, they are gradually becoming a little dated. The first thing that I would like to point out is this: a traditional computer software is designed for serial computation. What serial computation essentially means is that when you write an algorithm, the logic flow takes place from one point to other in terms of time. Now what it means is that a particular process must be completed before another process is taken up. Now you will say that, but we have heard about the parallel computers even in our traditional sense, but there is a very big difference. Yes, there are parallel computers in classical computers. I am using the phrase classical computers to mean the computers which we have today, which we have become accustomed to over the last nearly half a century or so. The concept of a parallel computer within our traditional computing platform is the following, that supposing I have a problem which can be broken up into independent logics which could be executed at the same time. Just to give you an example, supposing you are computing the product of two matrices. Now when you are computing the product of two matrices, then when you want to compute the first element of, let's say, product of AB equal to C, when you want to compute the first element of C, what we require is the first row of A and the first column of B, so that I can multiply them one after another and add them up. But during that time, in principle, I could be using, let's say, the second row of A and a second row, third or any other column of B to my advantage also, without interfering with the first computation. Now, but how do I do it? The only way to do it is if these different computations, which can be taken up simultaneously, are given to different processors and they are directed, that at this same time you could do it. In other words, each one still does a serial computation, but it's at the algorithmic stage that I split up my logic into processes which can be executed at the same time by different processors. So in other words, a traditional parallel computer must have n number of processors which could take up the job at the same time, and then we should integrate the results. Now, what is the difference? A quantum computer has what I will call as inherent parallelism. Now, let me try to explain what it is. But before that, let me also tell you a little bit which will give you an idea about what is the history of quantum computer. As I told you, it is not a very old thing, but the first person who can be credited with an idea of maybe having a quantum computer, he might not have quite thought of it that way, is Richard Feynman. All of you must have heard, a great scientist time, and probably better known because he was a very effective communicator and the greatest teachers that the physics has seen. Feynman in 1982 published a paper and which was titled Simulation of Physics Using a Computer. The question that he asked is, can one simulate physics using a computer? Now, there are many problems with it. The first problem is, how do you simulate time? As we know, time is a continuous variable. The problem of simulating time is that I must then somehow or other discretize time. Now, you would immediately realize this is a problem, but not that great a problem, because after all, we have been accustomed to discretizing time in solving differential equations. But the bigger problem is that we will see later in detail that in quantum mechanics, the measurements give you probabilistic result. As you are aware that a state in quantum mechanics is a linear combination of certain states, and when you do a measurement, let's suppose I talk about linear combination of some basis state, and when we make a measurement of any physical property of the system, one of the possible values of that physical property is realized with certain probability. Now, this is something which is totally new concept in quantum mechanics, and we have not seen a parallel like that in classical physics. So, this probabilistic aspect is one of the problems that we come up with. But then the problem is that simulate quantum processes using a computer. Then, can we use the quantum principle to our advantage to, let's say, build a computer? Now, this is roughly the idea. Now, I could mention other people who have been involved in its progress, but then I think I would take a jump to about 12 years later. There is Peter Shor who came up with an algorithm which we will be discussing in this course later. In 1994, he came up with an algorithm which showed that a very old problem that we have in computational science can be effectively solved if you had a quantum computer. Now, let me explain what that problem is. We will come to mathematical details of that during this course. The problem is connected with how to factorize a large composite number. Now, this has been known to be a very difficult problem, or as computer scientists call it, hard problem in computer science. And the reason why it is a hard problem is that there are no effective algorithms known which can compute the factors of a large composite number in what in computer science language is called in polynomial time. If it could be done in polynomial time, then of course it would be called an easy problem. I would later on point out that even today, we depend on this difficulty in factorizing a large composite number to have encryption of data. And in fact, RSA algorithm which provides the data encryption depends on the relative hardness of the factorization problem and with respect to the multiplication, which is relatively easy. And if one can break this RSA code, which at least theoretically is possible today thanks to source algorithm, then it would mean a substantial advancement in both cryptography and in computer science. So what Peter Schrodt showed is that using the principles of quantum mechanics, we can factorize a large composite number. Now you may say that this essentially gave us or heralded the coming of the quantum computers into the field. Even today, there are no quantum computers which is available liberally, but there are prototype models. And in fact, the original number which was factorized using Peter Schrodt's principle on a quantum computer is just the number 15, which of course doesn't require a quantum computer, but it was the principle of the thing that got established. The reason why quantum computation is different from the classical computation is the fact that while a classical register can at a given time have or be in one state, that is, let's suppose I am talking about a simple classical bit and I have a 1-bit register. The 1-bit register can stay either in state 0 or in state 1. Similarly, a 2-bit register can be in state 00, 01, 10, 11. The difference between this statement and the corresponding quantum mechanical statement is that in quantum mechanics, not only I can have a register storing any of these 4 states in the second example that I give you, but it can be simultaneously in a linear combination of these 4 states. And not only that, that when you actually compute a function, then one can compute the value of the function for this linear combination. In other words, you compute the value of the function for each one of the inputs at the same time. In other words, the parallelism that we are talking about for a quantum computer is inherent. And it's not an outside parallelism which has been thrust on us by having number of processors. So there's another important thing that comes up, that quantum bits, which we will later on give it a name, call it qubits, they have another property, interesting property, known as entanglement. Now, an entanglement, which of course requires a minimum 2-qubit system, is something which has no parallel in corresponding classical computer. What it means is that the 2 bits or 2 qubits of a particular state are not individually realizable, and if you measure one of them, the state of the other one gets automatically determined. We will be seeing a lot of this entanglement in this course. Now let's come back to what is the need of a quantum computer other than for solving hard problems. The main problem that is gradually coming up over the last several years, you have seen the computers, the classical computers as I will be using the term, have generally increased in their speed. Now, how has it been possible? This has been possible because of great deal of miniaturization being achieved in integrated circuits. But that carried with it a problem. There is a law which the electronics engineers or the computer scientists referred to as Moore's law, which stated that the number density of transistors on an integrated circuit doubles every 18 months or 2 years. Now, if that were so, or if that is so, then the spacing between the transistors or the other components, they keep on decreasing. Now, when miniaturization proceeds like this, there are 2 problems associated with it. When the separation between different components, they reach atomic dimension. You are all aware of quantum mechanical uncertainty principle due to Heisenberg. Now, that has a lot of influence on what is happening when things reach atomic dimension. In other words, if the components come so close, then the results that you get out of that computation will no longer be reliable. The other thing that will happen is that the heat produced by one of the components would naturally affect the performance of nearby components, and so therefore this would also make the computation unreliable. There is this heat problem has certain other aspects. For instance, the heat produced by a computer depends on the volume occupied by the number of gates. But you need to remove the heat continuously, and heat can be removed only from the surface. So as a result, when the components come too close, efficiency of removing heat will not be quite as good. There is a principle which is known as Landauer principle, which says every physically irreversible process, you are all familiar with many irreversible processes that take place while doing computation. For example, if you have an AND gate, it is an irreversible process. Most of the processes in classical computing are done irreversibly. And this principle, Landauer principle, states that every n bit of information increases the thermodynamic entropy by n k log 2, which would mean that there is certain amount of loss of energy and the process becomes gradually inefficient as the number of components increase. The present day computers dissipate much more energy than this limit. The quantum processes, as we will see later, have to be carried out reversibly. In fact, the operators which will be doing it will be unitary operations. Now, it is also possible to do classical computing by means of reversible gates, but then there is always a problem of what we call as a garbage. And the garbage arises because, for example, if I am using an AND gate and I want it to be done reversibly, what it means is I have to store the inputs continuously. In fact, the only classical gate which is a reversible gate is a NOT gate. But for all others, if I want the process should be done reversibly, I will need to collect the inputs which I do not later on require. So that becomes a very big disposal problem, and it also takes unnecessary storage. So these are the two primary issues connected with the advent of quantum computers. Now, let me tell you about what are the things that I am going to be doing in this course. I will be actually aiming to do quite a bit in detail two major. The first one is known as Grover's database. This is a problem which requires of the order of n queries in classical computing. But as we will see later, quantum database search of an unstructured database can speed this process up quadratically. That is, require only square root of n number of queries. That is, instead of n, it depends upon square root of n. I started talking about the source algorithm more for historical reasons. But the source factorization algorithm is a major advancement in the area, because till this algorithm has been known, the classical computers could not solve a problem, the problem of factorization, in what we will call as a polynomial time. In computer science, the complexity of a problem is determined by the dependence of the resources that the algorithm requires on the length of the input string. By resources, we mean time, memory, etc. Let's suppose I am multiplying two numbers. One could say that the way it depends upon time depends on, let us say, n square plus 5n. Now, mind you, these will not be the same for two different computers, but we are talking about order of magnitude. So, I would then say that this complexity of this problem is order n square. In general, if I can express the complexity as a polynomial function of the length of the string, then I say this problem's complexity is polynomial time. And in computer science, an algorithm which can be executed in polynomial time is considered as an easy problem. Of course, you could have a problem which depends upon logarithm of the resources, which also is an easy problem. Constant time algorithms are also easy problems. But supposing I cannot express it as a polynomial, if it depends upon 2 to the power n, 2 is the normal base of exponential in computation, then it is called an exponential time algorithm and the problem is now considered hard. Factorization problem is one of the hard algorithms. What Peter Schott showed is that one can solve the factorization problem in polynomial time if you had a quantum computer. I will begin this course with a review of the postulates of quantum mechanics. The postulates of quantum mechanics that I will be talking about are basically what are known as the Copenhagen interpretation. I will be introducing the concept of a qubit, quantum bit, which is similar to the classical bits, but as I already mentioned that my registers can simultaneously store linear combination of such qubits. We will see an attractive geometrical interpretation of these qubits on a sphere called Bloch sphere. Since this course is heavily dependent on linear algebra, I will be spending a bit of a time on elements of linear algebra and will be introducing the Dirac notation of quantum mechanics, which is commonly used in discussing quantum computing. We will see that the traditional quantum mechanics which we learn in universities, they depend on or they describe what are called pure systems. In reality, we rarely have pure systems, but we are likely to have either mixed systems or even pure systems which interact with surroundings. We will be introducing the concept of density matrix, which is more appropriate way of defining or discussing the quantum mechanics for such mixed systems or ensemble of systems. After that, we will be bringing up the idea of what we call as a circuit model of quantum computer, and that is basically to introduce various gates which are similar to the classical gates that we have, but with certain prescription that these gates must execute tasks unitarily and reversibly. One of the biggest problems that we have in quantum computers is the problem of measurement. As we have seen, that measurement in quantum mechanics does not give you the state of the system at that time, because the state of the system could be a linear combination of various states. And so what will happen is that you will get on measurement only one of those states coming out. And this state which is projected out due to measurement is probabilistic in nature. So this actually causes a very big problem, but we will see how to use this to our advantage and extract what we require. We will be bringing up a theorem known as quantum no cloning theorem, which tells us that we cannot duplicate a quantum state. And we will see that how a quantum state can be transported from one place to another by a very interesting algorithm known as quantum teleportation. we will be then introducing simple quantum algorithms. But in addition to making a logical conclusion of the course towards the two major algorithms that we talk about, we will be bringing up something which are fairly interesting tests of quantum mechanics. One of the paradoxes of quantum mechanics was pointed out by Einstein, Podolsky and Rosen. As you might recall, that one of the persons who never believed the Copenhagen interpretation of quantum mechanics was Albert Einstein himself. And this, he presented a paradox which is known as EPR paradox, and that has become a subject of intense debate among the leaders of quantum mechanics and those who believed in the alternate theory known as the hidden variable theory. John Bell provided a what we may call as a conclusive test to determine which one of the theories is right. These require certain inequalities known as Bell's inequality, and we will be talking about them in this course. Once we have completed the quantum computing part, we will be spending the last few lectures on the aspects of quantum information theory. But before that, we will have a quick review of classical information. We all understand what is information. In some loose sense, it means knowledge, but we will see what is the way of quantifying or measuring information, both classical information and quantum information. And we will see that, interestingly, a quantity known as entropy, with which you have familiarity in your thermodynamics course, comes to our rescue. And finally, towards the last one or two lectures, we will be giving you an overview of practical realization of a quantum computer. This course will be primarily based on the most standard reference that is there, by Nielsen and Chuang's quantum computation and quantum information. But as I will be doing a lot of linear algebra, there is a linear algebra based text by Nakahara and Obi on quantum computing. I will also be giving a detailed list of other books that are available in the market for quantum computation. With this, I will begin my regular exposition of quantum computing, starting with the postulates of quantum mechanics.